Shalom. Welcome to OCN Broadcasting, Open Door Communication Network. I'm Pastor Ruth, and this is River of Life Hebrew Studies. This is our yeshiva, our Hebrew school, here at OCN. So welcome. We've got a great study for you tonight, and I know you're going to enjoy it. You know, across the screen, you're going to be seeing occasionally something running across the bottom of the screen. That would be our phone number. And that will be our how to get there, OCN, www.ocnbroadcasting.com, or our post office box, several ways for you to communicate with us. So we would like you to communicate. You know, the lifeblood of every relationship is communication. So call us, email us, talk to us. We would love to hear from you. Anyway, we are. This is the second part in the series. We are talking, it's called Blessings Under Heaven or Life Under the Sun. You know, the book of Ecclesiastes tells about two aspects of life on the earth. One of them is life under heaven and heaven's blessing, and life under the sun. So we're going to be looking at those two aspects today, and we're going to be getting to a little bit more of the teaching on heaven itself, Shamayim, which is the word in Hebrew for heaven. I am going to read a little bit for you on the first chapter of Ecclesiastes. If you have your Bibles, if you'd like to turn with me to the first chapter of Ecclesiastes, we're going to be referring to a few of those verses in that chapter. The book of Ecclesiastes in Hebrew is called Kohelet. Okay, we're going to get to the meaning of that a little bit later. Okay, so Ecclesiastes 1, 1 through 3. Havel, empty. Havelim, emptiness. Amar said Kohelet. Havel, empty. Havelim, emptiness. Hakol, havel is emptiness. Ma Yitron, what benefit, La'adam, does man have, Bichal, in all, Hamalo, his labor, which he labors, Hashemesh, under the sun. So this portion was written by King Solomon. And King Solomon, you know, was the wealthiest man who ever lived and will live, and the wisest man who ever lived and ever will live. And we have some interesting commentaries. I'm doing a little review for you from last time because it's good to hear things again to get it back into your spirit. You know, the Talmud is rabbinic commentary. Someday we're going to do a class on all the different rabbinic commentaries and how they dovetail one to the other. But I'd like to tell you a few of the comments from one of the rabbis from the 11th century called Ramban. The Talmud explains that man's striving is futile only if his goal is for success in matters that are under the sun. But if he strives to advance in Torah and affairs of the Spirit, which preceded and surpassed the sun, then his activities are hardly futile. Is that interesting thought from that rabbi? He also sets forth these themes in Ecclesiastes. Number one, Solomon, the very wealthy king who knew what opulence was, proclaimed that the pleasures and allures of the world are fleeting and valueless. Two, spirituality is eternal, and man must recognize that his health, his life, his strength, his prosperity should be used to better enable him to serve others. Now, this is in a capsule, listening to what Ecclesiastes might want to be saying to us in this day, in this hour. You know, so many people are striving in their lives. I was just thinking of all the strife and all the striving that people are in today. And you might be in a situation where you feel like I am just striving, and I don't even know where I'm going. But God wants you to know that you have a purpose and a design over your life. And he even wants the work that you're doing to be pleasure. He even wants the work that you're doing to be something that gives back to you. It gives you joy. It gives you peace. It gives you the money that you need. And it gives you an opportunity to interact with other people and spread the good, spread the kingdom of heaven on earth. God wants good things for people under heaven. That's where he wants us to live. Now Solomon, he became greater than anyone before him and anyone after him. Solomon acquired so many things, vineyards and gardens and parks and fruit trees and pools and herds and flocks and silver and gold and music and on and on. He became greater than anyone before him and anyone after him. He said in Ecclesiastes 2, "Then I considered all the work of my hands had done and the toil I had expended doing it, and behold, all is vanity of vanities, havel, havelim, wind, and there is nothing I gained under the sun." Remember, we're talking about the two aspects of life, under the sun or under heaven. You know, heaven in Hebrew is a great concept in Hebrew. God lives in heaven. All goodness that we can have comes from heaven, from God. God has a design for everyone's life. All authority, all direction and election come from God. All protection from the angelic host comes from heaven. Do you believe that? If you've opened your Bible and you read it, you know and understand that there are angels that God has dispensed on our behalf. And we can call on him to send angelic help. Lots of angelic help over us and over our families for this day and this hour. That's from heaven. And those that have chosen to live under heaven and live under God and live in God's ways and under his authority, even Jesus himself, when he was here on the earth, said, "Not my will, but thine be done." So he knew there was a divine plan and design over his life. And he was willing to submit to that at this time, at his moment on the earth, so that he could fulfill the plan that became a blessing and redemption for all mankind. Greatness comes from heaven. Nevuah. What's Nevuah? It's the prophetic word. You know what? You can give insight into somebody's life, and God may have already spoken to them, and you're just giving confirmation. But that prophetic word can enliven something in them so that they can move ahead and do something that they already knew was in them. Inspiration comes from heaven. You know, all the books of the Bible were written by all Jewish people, by the way, and the inspiration came to them from heaven, from God, from the Holy Spirit, to write the words so that we would have a book. We would have something to lead our lives and guide our lives by. God is so awesome. Baruch Hashem Adonai, blessed be the holy name of God. When we are in God through our relationship with Yeshua, Jesus Christ, we live under heaven. Now, we can be in relationship with Jesus Christ and be saved, born again, he's in us. And we can choose to live outside of that will. He might be speaking something to your life and you choose not to do it. And the great blessing that he has for you, so then you might get into living under the sun, striving and strife and hardship. But God doesn't want you to live under that. He wants you to bring you back into the blessing. And the design he has for you isn't to control you. It's to help you. It's to frame your life with goodness. When we are under heaven, God's personal hand interacts with us. You know, in Acts chapter 10, there was an angel that visited a man in Acts chapter 10, a Cornelius. And the angel said, "A memorial offering from your prayers and your alms have come up before God." So this was a man, the scripture tells us, that feared God and prayed and gave alms to the poor. So he was a righteous man that feared God and prayed and gave alms to the poor. So you had somebody that was so directed by heaven that God sent an angel down to him and said, "Though that has reached God as a memorial before God." So God was going to remember some things in behalf of him. So if you're living under heaven, if you're living in that blessing, if you're living in that awesomeness of God, supernatural things can take place. An angel could visit you. You could have a blessing coming to you so much that you can't even hold it all. That's what God wants for your life. He doesn't want us to live a life of toil. You know, it says in James 5:16, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. You know, I'm standing here because I have a husband that is an effective, fervent, righteous man that prays much. And he understood the gift I had inside of me. And he encouraged me and said, Ruth, you need to go out. You need to teach Torah. Amen. And so the effectiveness of that prayer helped produce something in me and helped open doors for me. Amen. Do you understand that? Yes. I'm speaking to the women right now. And also to the husbands. You can speak into your family, and your prayers are so powerful over your family that God wants to join in with you, and he wants to give you something so awesome in your family. He wants the design over each one of their lives, your wife and your children, to come to pass. God is going to be in partnering with you. Praise his holy name. Okay, we are going to go to looking at page number 2. So in scriptures, the prophetic levels are, they start, I'm going to tell you about the highest level of the prophetic was Moshe. Moshe, it's Moses, because he talked with God face to face. It's considered the highest level of Nevuah. The highest level of prophecy was Moses. And it says in Exodus 34:10 that he spoke with God face to face. There was no prophet like Moses that spoke to God face to face. And the next one was the prophets, the Nevuim, the major prophets, and then the Tre'ezar, the 12 minor prophets. Now, the 12 minor prophets were shorter in length because of the sin of Israel. Do you understand this? Because of the sin of Israel, the Nevuah had decreased. The prophetic understanding had decreased, so that it was shorter in length. But I want to tell you this, that everything that happens in the world has to do with God and his people. You might say, well, they're this, and they're that, and they're evil, and they're bad. But it first starts out with God's people. It says in Deuteronomy 32:8, the bounds of the nations were set according to the sons of Israel. The bounds of the nations were set according to the sons of Israel. So everything in the world has to do with the sons of Israel. Well, you might say, I'm not Jewish. You might say, they're Jewish. I'm not Jewish. Well, are you in Christ? Yes. Galatians 3:29 said, if you be in Christ, yes, you are Abraham's seed and your heirs according to the promise. Amen. So the dealing of God and his people is what is happening in the world. So if the people of God are set apart for praying and seeking God and seeking his face and turning from their wicked ways, then you'll hear from heaven. Amen. So that's what God wants to do. He wants his people to be people that will change the atmosphere where they are, change the atmosphere in their home, change the atmosphere where they work. Bring blessing where you are. Wherever you go, you can bring goodness and you can bring blessing. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise his holy name. We're going to go to page 3 now, and I'm going to talk a little bit about Kohelet. That's what the word Ecclesiastes means in Hebrew. It sounds like this, Kohelet, okay? And that word Kohelet, okay, means one who assembles. One who assembles. So King Solomon assembled many branches of wisdom. One of the things that one who assembles means, it denotes an office. It also is one who addresses an assembly. And we usually, a lot of people think it means preacher, and that word preacher came from the Latin source. It isn't from the Hebrew. From the Hebrew, the source means one who assembles. So King Solomon assembled many branches of wisdom, but he also assembled many people to hear him. Both Jew and Gentile would come to hear the wisdom from this man. And his wisdom was practical wisdom. His wisdom was wisdom that can bring peace. You know that Solomon reigned twice as long as any king of Israel. He reigned 80 years. And it was a peaceful reign. Oh no, hold on. Raise the board. It was Joseph that reigned 80 years, and he was twice as long as any king. Solomon reigned 40 years, but he reigned 40 years in peace. So that wisdom that he had in him brought peace. It brought the shalom of God between relationships. It brought the shalom of God in many ways. So it was Solomon that assembled many branches of wisdom. Another word, you know, in the Hebrew language, if you want to go back to that other page, Jack, if you can, it shows the root word of that word, kohelet. It means kol. Okay, go on to the next one. I think we're going to go on to the next one that will have, there it is. At the bottom of the page, you can see the two blue things, and those are the words in Hebrew that means kol, and it means to assemble, okay? And that's where that word kohelet means one who assembles, and sheni kola means wisdom assembled within. Both of those words have that matching root of kol in it. Okay, so this is how the Hebrew language works. It works on a shorish. It works on a root system. And these roots of these words will tell you what another word matches to it, okay? And it'll give you a greater understanding. So Solomon, King Solomon, had wisdom assembled within him. So how many of you want Sheni Kohala? Wisdom assembled within you. Do you want to have practical wisdom for your family, for your life, for your children, for your future? God has great designs over everyone's life, and He assembles wisdom from His Word. He assembles wisdom from God's people and the uniting and the gathering of people. He assembles wisdom in many different ways. He assembles wisdom through a mother's prayers. He assembles wisdom through many, many things and many, many facets, and He wants to bring us that goodness from Shemayim so we can live under heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You know, there's no lasting value in toil in this world, okay? There's no lasting value in toil in this world, so why should we strive aimlessly for material things? They're not going to give you, you might have a little enjoyment for a while, and then your enjoyment goes down. But God wants to give you continual feast from heaven. You know, I'm going to tell you my dad's story today, so I want to get to that verse. Ecclesiastes 5:19 said, pleasure in work under heaven, to rejoice in your work is a gift of God. Amen. It's a gift of God to rejoice in your work. You know, God wants us to have goodness and joy in our life. And if it's not there, you might ask Him, where can I move under heaven to get it, okay? One of the quotes from Bill Johnson, he said, if you don't have joy and creativity in your walk with the Lord, you're going to move toward legalism. And you know, Jesus had trouble with the Pharisees of His day, so we don't want to move there. We want to live in goodness and joy. I want to give you a story about my dad today. We tried last week and it wasn't enough time, so I'm going to go there right now and show you his picture. You know, there's no one like my dad. He was incredible. He was an incredible person. I mean to tell you, the love and the joy and the creativity and the goodness that came around him was just absolutely incredible. And he looked for places to do good. He had this little airplane. He used to go off to different places and find places to build more condos or more apartments or more homes. He was a home builder. And he did that for 40 years. But I want to tell you this. When he was born and he grew up in northern Minnesota, dirt poor, they call it, I guess. They were very, very poor. He lived in a house that was 12 by 20. Do you get an idea of that size of that house? 12 by 20, they had 12 children. 12 children in that home. And it was a little farmhouse in northern Minnesota. It gets very cold there. And my grandma used to bake 12 loaves of bread every other day to feed her family. There were 10 boys and 2 girls. But they lived an incredible life because grandma went to the Baptist church and she got born again. And she started praying for her family. And out of that incredible family came teachers and preachers and business people, a scientist and a banker and everybody highly successful. But you get with that family and the stories they told about growing up and the fun they had, the joy that was in the atmosphere, incredible. Well, my dad had that kind of joy with him. And so after the war, he decided to start building houses. And the very first house he built with his own two hands. And he didn't even know how to build a house. He knew that these people were coming back from World War II and they had the GI Bill and they could get in free. And so he thought, I'll build houses. He got the design. The Lord showed him what to do, what was going to give him the best success, where he could do giving and loving people and helping people. So God gave him that design. And he would go around and look at the other builders, what they were doing at night, so he could figure out how to do things. And he went and he built his own house with his. My mom used to help him hold up the boards and stuff. Okay, that first house, he went and got permits for 5 more. And he never had to swing another hammer. But he put hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people to work for many, many years. And he built thousands of homes. And he was blessed incredibly. Whatever blessing he had, people would come to him because whatever he was doing was being blessed. Because he said, if you don't give when you're poor, you won't give when you're rich. So when they were poor, they had nothing. They had nothing. My dad brought a little granary on the edge of town when they were first married for $300. He put cupboards on one hand and a hide-a-bed on the other. They bought a car for $200, so for $500, they had a house and a car. They had nothing. So, but God, it built and went on from there when his business increased. But his love of giving was the most incredible thing. Anybody that had something knew they could come to him. He never said no. The family knew that he never said no. He never decided whether this person was for that or whatever. He never said no. What do you need? Boom, you got it. A ministry was, best friend was building a mission. What do you need? You've got it. Another friend was building a radio station, Christian radio station. You've got it. Another friend was having missionaries go all around the world with Campus Crusade. He used to go to Bill Bright's home here in California. What do you need? You've got it. And so he just loved giving. It was just his life, and he was fun to be around. He was a daddy. It was just incredible. And the love that came out of him and the joy he had in his work. You know, he'd fly that plane out and go to, he was in 8 different states, and he'd go somewhere, but he'd plan to be home for supper. And so he was home at 6 o'clock eating supper. He's with the family. I mean, he's a family man. You know, he was always with us. We went to church together. It was incredible, just an incredible life and a wonderful man. But he had the joy that came back to him in the most incredible way, and it just stayed with him his whole life wherever he went. The blessings flowed. We were in a ministry one time where the families all needed things at Christmas. He made sure every one of those men, women, and children had a Christmas gift at Christmas. There was a couple hundred people in that ministry. And then in that ministry, there were people who had little apartments that they were fixing up. He opened up an account at Sherwin-Williams and said, you just go down and sign your name, get the paint and the supplies and the wallpaper you need, and go and fix your little apartment up. You know, it just was incredible. What is the need? What is the need? There it is. You've got it. And you know what? If you position yourself under heaven, under Shemayim, God can bring a right design for your life, and he's going to bring the right people to come alongside of you, and maybe you can be the one to say, what do you need?
Amen.
Here you go. Do it. Do God's work. Do good. Love people. That's what we're doing here at OCN. We want to bring the goodness of Shemayim to you. We want you to understand that in your life, we care for you. We pray for you. And we understand that life is difficult sometimes. It was difficult when they first started, my mom and dad. They had nothing. But, you know, they just had joy. They had the Lord. When you got your salvation, you got the Lord. You have each other. Oh, my goodness. These are free things. You have each other. You get to love each other, and you get to love your children. You get to see them grow. What a gift from heaven is that? God wants to do that for you. He wants to bring you and position you under heaven. He wants to give you a bigger view of what he wants to do on the earth. Do you know there's so much going on in the world today? And we can look at the news and almost, you know, can hardly listen to the whole broadcast because the news is so hard to listen to. But we need to understand what's going on, because God's heart is for all of those people that are being hurt and tortured and killed. God's heart is there, and he's carrying them, and he wants us to be a part of that. So find what God wants you to do, and do it with all of your might. Do it with all of your resources. Do it with everything that you have inside of you, and you will have so much joy. You'll wake up happy. You'll go to sleep happy. People around you will feel the joy. People will start asking you about things, and you'll be able to share with them the goodness of heaven. The goodness of heaven. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I want to bless you today with the goodness of Shemayim, that God would come to your family and he would meet your need, and that you would call on him, and that he would quickly hear you and answer you. You know, he's waiting for your voice. He's listening for your voice. He's waiting to hear your voice. And he is going to usher that up as a memorial before him. And he's going to hear your prayer. I want to encourage you mothers to pray. You know, my grandma was a praying grandmother. And my dad said 8 of the brothers went into World War II. And grandma prayed because 8 of her sons were in World War II. In different locations and areas. I don't have time to tell you the whole story, but there were many stories where one ship sunk and one of the guys got sick and they had to put him in the hospital on land, and that ship sunk. And there were many other stories where some of those boys were saved because grandma was praying. I'm telling you, your prayers are effective. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. And God is waiting to hear your prayers, and he's waiting to intervene on your behalf. And no matter what you're facing today, it's not too hard for God. His love will reach out to you. His help and his mercy, his great chesed will reach out to you. His loving kindness will be extended to you, and he will not forget about you. I want to encourage you today to just pray and ask him to come into your life. Come into your life. And you would know him. You would know your Savior and Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Thank you, Jesus, for filling me with your love and your life. In the name of the Lord, we bless the name of the Lord. Baruch Hashem Adonai. We bless your holy and righteous name. Praise his holy name. Praise his holy name. The river is flowing. It's flowing into your life right now. I feel the anointing coming to you over the airwaves. Mm-hmm.